I want to start my presentation giving a special tribute, in fact a double tribute to Mario. One is related to, of course, our common career and the work we've conducted together from time to time. And the second one is more directly related to the fact that this is taking place in Italy, and that is the second special connection I have with this event, which is that my blood is 50% Italian, my mother is Italian. And that's why I thought, because of course Mario is part of that history, I wanted to somehow give an explanation of the well-known SPQR, the famous Roman, related with the topic of my presentation. So excuse the pun, but SPQR can be translated as shown here. And I'm going to talk about the more general problem of privacy in the framework of autonomic vehicular networks. Another personal short story I would like to tell about Mario is that he is the only person I've been able to find in the world to do something, a dream I had for so many years, which was to climb the Stromboli volcano. Mario was a very, very, very fond of volcanoes. And exactly as Jan said earlier, after we had gone up the volcano at night, we came down at 11 p.m., had a short dinner, and when we were about to go to bed at 6, Mario asked me, what about going up at 6 a.m. for a swim? No, Mario, you do it, I can't. Well, all right, so let's get started with the topic of this presentation. I wanted to start the presentation with a quick presentation of the trolley problem. The trolley problem, as you may know, has to do with a fictitious situation where you're sitting by a switch, a railway switch, and there is a trolley that is arriving. And if you don't intervene, the four people that are tied to the tracks are going to die. If you intervene, the switch, then there is only one person who is going to die. The problem is that there will be lethal consequences. And the question is whether you are part of the decision to kill someone or not. But I don't want to spend too much time on this problem, because there are many, many considerations. It can be utilitarian ethics or any other form of ethics. And there is no definite answer. Translated into the topic of the autonomous vehicle networks, the situation is, imagine you are driving a car and you are facing the situation where you have to kill someone, including yourself. The first question is, who do you kill? And you don't have much time to make a decision. And the second interesting question is, who is you? Is it a human driver? Hey, if we're talking about driverless cars in the future, that doesn't make any sense. So the you might well be an algorithm that is being run by an onboard system that has been designed years ago by engineers in some company. They have left the company since then when the situation occurs. And even the company might have disappeared. So in case there is a legal case due to this, who is going to be blamed? Who is liable? And who is able to claim today that whatever the future might be regarding this kind of situation, it is possible to design today an algorithm that will always make the good decision, the best decision? This is a very, very difficult question. So we are talking about human lives, essentially. So let's, sorry, I'm still using the wrong one. So let's talk about safety issues. And then later on, we'll look at ethical issues and privacy issues in autonomous vehicular networks. So far, vehicles on the roads, autonomous vehicles, are run under robotics algorithms, sensors and robotics. The only solid foundation today are brought to us by the roboticist community. Years ago came the idea that we had to augment robotics with intervehicular communications. And that's good reason for this. What I want to make clear is, first, there are two choices. You can think of intervehicular communication via radio and or via optics. For some reason, the standards committees, the Big Auto community, the Cooperative Intelligent Transportation System community has ignored optical communication right from the start. I believe this is a big mistake, especially when you look at the problem from the privacy angle. The second observation I'd like to share with you is that the solutions that have been decided, which are already translated into standards, US standards, IEEE standards, and ST standards in Europe, and supposedly having radio transceivers in cars deployed on the roads is going to be mandatory by 2020 in the USA. So these solutions are coming on us. So it may make sense when you are a scientist to look, to dig deep enough to know whether, in fact, we are going to save lives with these technologies or not. And the answer, as far as I'm concerned, is no. Basically, the solutions are based on omnidirectional broadcasting. The MAC protocol is CSMA/CA, and we all know since the early work by Professor Kleinrock and colleagues that there is no upper band on delays with CSMA/CA. So we're talking about technology that's going to increase safety achieved by robotics via communication that may take a known time to reach vehicles. Nonsense. The second poor decision made, to my point of view, is that they're going to use period beaconing. That is to say, the idea is to have every vehicle tell the world, well, within a radius of 350 meters, here I am, there is a vehicle here. And written in clear in the body of the messages, you have the GPS position. And that is done every 100 milliseconds or at maximum once per second. So can you imagine that it is very easy for malicious participants, so to speak, to spy on, you know, to track what you do, where you stop, what kind of journey you are making, more or less regularly, for instance, on a daily basis. And in the end, it is possible to know, despite the fact that no names should appear in the source fields of messages that are broadcast, to know who you are. And finally, all these solutions rely a lot on cloud-based services, notably because in order to obfuscate identities of broadcasters, they use pseudonym schemes, which are good. The problem is when you couple with periodic beaconing, you lose the beauty of pseudonym schemes. So my conclusion, and I can discuss with anyone about whether or not this can be demonstrated, it can be demonstrated. V2X, vehicle to anything communications, are harmful. So after I told you about no bounded delays regarding the Mach level figures, there is no bounded delay either when you want to disseminate a message, emergency message, throughout a strings of vehicles in order to implement common knowledge. So all vehicles participant in a given string know what to do, brake, accelerate, clear lane, or whatever. The problem is that when you don't have any upper band for, where's the light? For small delta, you cannot have any upper band for big delta, especially because you have to account for failures, message losses. And the question that has no answer in publication today or in the standards is, give me the upper band of the number of losses that will occur when I will be disseminating a message within a string of N, 20, for example, 20 vehicles. Not knowing this upper band just kills the solutions based on V2X. There are other solutions suggested in blue. I'm not going to waste too much time on that. You have to believe me. And furthermore, as I said, because of the broadcasting nature of these V2X solutions, vehicles are prone to cyber attacks, which don't exist with robotics. So in fact, rather than increasing safety properties with V2X, you're degrading safety properties ensured by robotics. Now, let's get to privacy. Of course, if vehicles broadcast their position at a frequency ranging between 1 and 10 hertz, it's very easy to, as I said, to track vehicles, and therefore to infer who is in a given vehicle following a specific path. Facing this reality, after so many years of work, the cooperative ITS community openly admits today that you cannot have safety and privacy at the same time. They forgot to complete the sentence. You cannot have safety and privacy with our solutions. But this is not a universally true statement. There is no proof. And in fact, it is the opposite. The best way to prove that this is not true is to prove that you can have safety and privacy jointly by design. And that is feasible. So now the reason why I picked up that topic is because Mario and myself have been exchanging information more or less regularly via Skype during the last year. I was able to talk to Mario, and he had published a paper on privacy, and we have discussed this issue quite a number of times. Now, regarding privacy, besides scientific issues that I don't have time to explain here, you have legal issues and regulatory issues. You might be aware, we are in Italy, that last year the European Union has made it mandatory to obey what they call the GDPR regulation regarding the protection of data which has some personal aspect. The question is, how do you implement the GDPR ruling in autonomous cars? Basically, GDPR says, before you collect data about passengers, you must get the explicit consent from passengers. How do you do that today? In fact, the auto industry is doing exactly the opposite. They are installing cameras, infrared sensors, to watch you, the driver, and the passengers. They know everything that's happening in a car, that will be happening in automated cars. Who is there, what they say, when they travel together. And this is already happening with the latest Tesla models and some Cadillac models. So rather than obeying the GDPR regulation, they are doing exactly the opposite. No question asked, you are being pictures and recorded. There is another report that has been issued by a United Nations Commission which states a few facts regarding what the auto industry is doing. This is just an excerpt. I'm not sure you can read it. But in fact, what they say, that was published in 2017, they say, please, auto industry, you are seriously urged to respect privacy of passengers. So in some sense, they are telling the auto industry, redo everything from the start. You have followed the wrong track, and you should do it differently. Now, the reason for this, why is it the case that, you could ask the question, why is it the case that the auto industry is following that track? Well, it has nothing to do with engineering or science. It has to do with 750 billion of US dollars predicted in 2030. This is the market predicted about wireless communication worldwide in 2030. And there is no reason why the auto industry is going to leave it all to GAFAM and BATX. So they want to have their share of it. And the V2X solutions are ideal for spying on passengers or future automated cars. Now, back to a little bit of science. The spec problem, safety, privacy, efficiency, and cybersecurity, is the problem you start from. And then you design. And you, in the end, you know which kind of communication technology you need, not doing the opposite, which has been done so far. And in fact, the problem is not so much about communication. It has to do with secure, reliable, distributed coordination of vehicles. If you want to avoid collisions, fatalities, you have to have explicit coordination between cars when they're too close to each other, or when suddenly hard brakes. So it's more close, it's closer to the real problem to talk about coordination rather than communication. Communication is a technology for implementing coordination. And you might have been asking yourself this question, how is it that birds and fish, more generally, are able to fly together in very compact groups, do fantastic motions in 3D space without hitting each other? Well, it appears that scientists who have been working on naturalistic studies, notably Princeton University, came with the conclusion for a bird in a flock of birds, it suffices to monitor 7 neighbors. And by transitivity, the whole group behaves collectively, safely. Hey, what about applying this concept of limited neighborhood to a future automated car? That's what we do, humans. We watch our neighbors in order to make sure that they're not going to eat our car. And this is exactly one of the ideas behind the other solutions. Very short-range directional communications among vehicles. And the other one is to bring some structure to networks of vehicles. And this is one of the cyber-physical constructs, which is called cohort. And I don't have time to explain exactly what is involved with that, but at least you can prove that if you buy this cyber-physical construct, if you build on top of the work done by the roboticist, you're bringing a new dimension, which I call cyber-physical levels, where every vehicle knows the maximum braking power of the vehicle ahead. You prove, theoretically, zero rear-end collisions, whatever the velocity and whatever the number of vehicles in a cohort. And this is exactly what we are looking for. Final slide. Time has come for our community, whether we are users or scientists or engineers or lawyers working together, time has come to make a decision. Of course, more has to be said about these future solutions that don't have the drawbacks of V2X solutions, but that is that has begun. You can find publications in good conferences where you see bricks of solutions moving in that direction. And in the end, the question is that we have to choose. It's too late for smartphones. We are using smartphones, and we are being spied on by whoever wants to spy on us with our smartphones. It's too late. It's not too late with automated cars. We can just do what someone famous in the US, Ralph Nader. Ralph Nader combated GM because their cars were unsafe. He won. GM had to change the way they built cars. And even more than that, the Department of Transportation created NHTSA, the administration in charge of road safety in the US, thanks to Mr. Ralph Nader, a lawyer. So I'm waiting for the new Ralph Nader. We are waiting for him. And there are lawyers who are inviting scientists to back them with scientific facts in order to win the battle, to stop what is going on and change future solutions for fully automated cars, you know, have these cars running on provably correct solutions. It's a decision on us. Thank you.